Hello, folks, and welcome to more WePlay action. We've got Vega versus Hellraisers. I'm Llama Down Under, joined by Mod Packs, and I'm
Five
hoping this one
seconds
lasts more
remaining.
than 25 minutes.
Vega squadrons turn to ban.
Might have been slightly muted there. No problem.
Radiant
No
may have
problem.
been. It may have
No,
been.
maybe.
Who knows? Who
No.
knows? 25 minutes. Do you think we can do it? Do you think it will be more, or do you think it's going to be even shorter?
That's a pretty good question. It really comes down to the draft, honestly. Like the Chen gone,
Vega
so really that
squadrons
changes the
turn
whole
to ban.
landscape of the game. That hero, we've seen some people get Chen'd. They got Chen'd. It happens. So without him, he kind of changed the whole landscape. Like you have to look at way different heroes for the early ganks. The Earth Spirit's still in the pool. If Vega want to rock that, put a lot of pressure on the mid lane. And without the Chen, like you tend to see that a lot more, right? Like you tend to see these Tusks and these Earth Spirits and Night Stalkers even come into the pool because you're not so concerned about the defensive
10 seconds
heroes that you require
remaining.
up against, these roaming in creeps, troll traps, Hadoukens,
Five
etc.
seconds
My goodness,
remaining.
the Hadouken is so strong, but story for another day because Oracle gonna be what gets through. Vega Squadron happily
Vega
pick up the Venge,
squadrons
could go
turn
for
to
the
ban.
DP if they want to pseudo block pick it, although Oracle and DP actually don't have a great win rate together, but we'll see what Vega prioritize. Also, what else is super strong that's left in the pool? They might pick up an offlaner here if they want to really cover their bases.
Yeah, the Mag Beastmaster left in the pool. It's interesting because like you can kind of play the game where you think Hellraisers won't ban it in the next two. But they I think
10
that's the play here
seconds
actually,
remaining.
because you have the Vengeful Spirits, so you already have like the suit like the counter void pick
Five
in a lot of
seconds
ways where like
remaining.
you don't think Hellraisers are gonna grab it. Obviously the Oracle, that's like the number one thing Hellraisers do
Reserve
prioritize
time.
because it offers a
I
lot of the
speak
same
for the
stuff.
trees.
So they'll just grab the profit for now,
Radiant
pretty
team
much giving
kill.
away the fact that it's gonna be for Meg. Of course, plenty of teams still opting for this kind of wild, safe lane Nature's Prophet, but unlikely we'll see that from Vega.
I'm actually a little surprised Vega went with the Nature's Prophet this early. As you said, I think picking up
Radiant
another
healer
support here or
ban.
something else, it would have forced Hellraisers to ban
Vega
out Beastmaster
squadrons
and Faceless
turn to
Void unless
ban.
they were going to pick it up. And I think it's just a better drafting strategy. You force out bans on one of your heroes. Maybe they were worried that the Nature's Prophet would be the ban, but
Yeah.
who knows? Either way, it's done. We got a Zeus
10
ban out
seconds
because global
remaining.
strats OP.
Yeah, you get it like
Five
Nature's
seconds
Prophet kind of does a lot of
remaining.
the same stuff, opening up your draft to all those potentials. And again, he offers that same early aggression that you can kind of
Reserve
cater more
time.
towards the Chen in the pool, and from the offlane position, whereas usually we're looking for that four roll roamer.
Yeah, there's a lot of potential to come in. Whoever is this mid for Hellraisers might be in for a really rough time because the Venge could be smoked up coming in, and Nature's Prophet with a Sprout makes your life difficult. They actually ban out
Radiant
the
team
Faceless
ban.
Void. Hey,
Yeah, they
Vega,
have to. It's too good with Witch Doctor.
So for Hellraisers, more opportunities to ban out mids or whatever else they want. You might just go for something safe like getting rid of the Jug so there isn't an early push or the Sven.
10 seconds
Yeah, it's true. It's so
remaining.
hard up against the Nature's Prophet, like because you've already banned out the Zeus, so they will go with the Spectre. Vega
Vega
probably.
squadrons turn to ban.
I would ban the Death Prophet, honestly, because that's like the only hero that you would have to worry about, but instead they just don't want to
Vega
have to deal with any sort of like a
squadrons
Shasha
turn to
Broodmother coming
pick.
out here. Also understandable.
Drow Ranger.
And we get a Drow strat. Oh, like, what do you do against Nature's
Radiant
Prophet, honestly?
team
Like, he bans
kill.
Zeus and Spectre, they still had the Sven, as he talked about, left in the pool, but you know what? Let's just go the other way. We already got a Vengeful Spirit. Let's go Drow. And now you need some sort of a gap closer. Hellraiser just banned out the Spectre, which is kind of comical. So now how do you get on top of the Drow Ranger? You kind of need one of those initiating cores, Witch Doctor, Oracle, two supports that don't offer that whatsoever. So now you have to look into like a Blink Sven, possibly an Ember Spirit is pretty common trying to go up against that.
Ten
I think I might like
seconds
that for Alpha
remaining.
Ninja with his Zeus being banned out as well.
Five Drow
seconds
strat,
remaining.
not really popular anymore, and so we'll see exactly if it
Reserve
works
time.
out. Also, getting some complaints that we're a little bit low. I'll work on upping the volume of both of us in a second, folks, so hopefully that'll impact you all in 2 minutes. But Broodmother gonna be the ban out because, again, another one of those heroes, you just have to get rid of it if you don't have a draft against it. And now Hellraisers. Now they're gonna show us what stuff they're made of. Because,
Yeah,
I mean,
the brood, like you cannot have brood up against Drow. If you have Drow and they pick brood, it's almost like always game over. I would love to see the actual stats on that, but I don't want my keyboard flying all over the cast here. And yeah, now you just got to figure out like what are you gonna do with your Witch Doctor? How are you gonna be able to get his Death Ward down into some sort of position? So it will be the Alpha Ninja Puck. Same
Vega
idea as the Ember. Get on
squadrons
top of that
turn
Drow,
to pick.
offer up the control for the Witch Doctor. Also, a very signature Alpha Ninja hero. So this looks good.
Yeah, something he's very comfortable with. Now, I've seen him have problems before. It's better. There's a lot of reasons it's good here. Obviously, it also has some defenses against a Nature's Prophet using the Sprout. Not going to be so easy to catch out, but there are still some really squishy supports on Hellraiser that if Nature's Prophet comes down to the tri lane occasionally, it can just really turn a fight, especially with a Drow Venge. Already you've got a lot of good auras. Or Vega, though. 5 seconds
remaining. Okay, I checked. You lose about a 10% win rate if you're Drow up against the Brood, so not that much of a surprise. It's just like no way to clear Spiderlings. But anyway, Vega, I would like a Night Stalker.
You just love the Oracle.
Yes, I do. I think the hero is like super broken. I think China has the right idea prioritizing in like first pick, first ban. But they still have the Viper for the mid lane. Obviously, going to be even harder to go up against it when he has the Drow aura. Like, good luck, Puck. And typically, you do see this like fifth hero that's usually not going to be ranged offers a lot of the controls, so you'll see your Tidehunters, your Earthshakers, that kind of hero coming up for Vega Squadron. But honestly, with Meg on the offlane role, I think it would be okay to go for some sort of an aggressive like Earth Spirit, Tusk, or Night Stalker here from Vega Squadron to really... The reason I like Night Stalker is the Silent Token, because the Puck is just like so good. And then you'd have that comped up with the Drow. So this mech though from the Viper was the perfect pick for them.
Yeah, it's going to get them online super early. This push is coming early on. Viper, it's really uncharacteristic for him to lose his lane. So it all should be good for Vega, looking like a strong early game. And Hellraiser's so far, just the Puck. I'm not sure they're repelling it so easily. There is, of course, a Gyro in the pool, one of the best things to deal with Flat Cannon. Flat Cannon, one of the best things to deal with the Nature's Prophet, having lots of units. What else do you think they could go for?
It really is like the Gyro, one of the better ones here. They'll grab the Earthshaker for themselves, so that'll be a core here. Another classic up against the incoming push. Pretty good getting an early Blink Dagger. Get on top of that Drow Ranger, comboed up with the Treants, of course, to add a little bit of extra damage, but... this is still looking pretty rough. I think you just ban the Gyro here as Vega. It is just really good. You know, get the Wombo combo, good high ground defense for when they're pushing in early. And then the only other option really for Hellraisers, I think, is just like a safe lane Ember. Like, you need to kind of rat this game out, push it, go for a Morphling probably actually for Illidan would be the pick here. Yeah. Either Morphling or Animage for Illidan.
Yeah. I'm also... Illidan's drafting, I just realized that. I haven't gotten to see a lot of Hellraiser's drafts. I've actually seen them play, but I sometimes miss the draft just based on when I wake up. And so I'm not sure, has he been drafting for them recently a lot?
I believe so, since he shut... Well, I mean, he's very new. It's only been like a couple games since he's joined them after his stint with PR.
Yeah.
From what I understand, Hellraiser's are looking to permanently sign him. They're hoping. Really surprised by that spend ban. I don't think that's something that you're going to see Illidan on. It's just not an Illidan hero, but
you say that,
could be
but
a nice little bit of cleave.
He's got a huge hero pool.
It's true. It's just like, when I think of like Illidan, I'm just thinking like God tier, Morphling, and Animage, and even like an Ember Spirit would be just so solid here. But Sven would be the more, I guess, meta pick right now.
Yeah, I think that it's going to be interesting. I mean, I like Sven. I think he's a strong hero. But as you said, you sometimes have to be a bit careful. You maybe wouldn't have been worried about Illidan picking it up. Either way, I don't think it's a complex hero. For Vega, they need another support here. There's still the Dazzle. They could go for that. It would sustain their push well. They would leave them very light on lockdown.
Yeah, it just depends what route you want to go. And oh, there you go. It'll be the lockdown of the Disruptors. Oh, I love Disruptor and these push strats, honestly. It's so good with Drow Ranger, obviously, because you get the bonus damage. But it's so great when you're pushing into a tower and Hellraisers have a failed defense. And it's what I like to call the and one, because you end up getting the tower. And then when they have to back away, you get your like a free pick using the glimpse, possibly even forcing them to commit into a team fight. Oh, so good. Definitely the pick here from Vega Squadron. Even get the Silence up against the Puck, too. So it offers everything that the Night Stalker was able to offer in terms of the aggression and getting like some kills without the commitment, because you're using the Glimpse and the Static Storm to set it all up.
5 seconds. Yeah, it's really nice here. Obviously, it will help you get the pick before. And I'm just not sure exactly how we're setting up the best of Static Storms on more than one target. But still, looks like an all-around really strong draft by Vega. Everybody buffed up by Drow here. And Chaos Knight gonna be what comes out. That's more of an Illidan hero. I love seeing this guy. We don't get to see him much.
Yeah, very popular lately. Kind of being shown off a bit during the Captain's Draft tournament with a lot of the other cores being out. He's also been seen in a ton of high MMR pub games lately. Good for trying to deal with a little bit of early aggression just because he, like, his damage is insane. You can just blow up a single target. He offers that idea of getting on top of the Drow Ranger, trying to burst her down as fast as possible, eliminate that aura. And it's also good against Ventral Spirit because the swap, like, it's harder to like use the stuns and the swap, but it's all single target control other than the disruptor. So with the illusions, it can kind of help out with that. And yeah, it looks pretty even. I think you gotta give the edge to Vega Squadron only because push lineups seem very favorable right now in the current patch. They've been doing really
Ten
well.
seconds
But if you can
remaining.
just hold out, get that nice high ground defense, Chaos Knight is one of those heroes that seems
5 seconds
unstoppable
remaining.
after like 35 minutes, Like he just offers so much in terms of control and the complete blow-up damage that he can give to you.
Yeah, I think another thing that's really nice here for Vega, their lineup's just easier to execute. I mean, you don't have something terribly complicated. Do okay in the lanes. You don't even need to necessarily win them because when you group up, you're much, much stronger. Viper shouldn't lose his lane. Maybe something goes a little bit funky with the tri lane, but I'm not expecting it. The only person who might be in trouble here, it feels like, is the Nature's Prophet up against the Earthshaker and the Witch Doctor. Although, do you think that HL might try for an aggro try?
You definitely could actually. That's probably the play. Try and get in the face. Like we've seen quite a few Chaos Knights going for that lately. I mean, he is really strong in lane, let's be honest. You get one Chaos Bolt can then set up anytime you have a carry that's able to set up, whether it be Sven or even looking into like your Wraith Kings, always gonna be better in an aggro try than someone who doesn't provide that sort of a element to the tri lane. So I would really like to see that. You need to shut down this Drow because if you can slow down the progression, maybe even force a couple points into the gust early on and the frost arrows, that's gonna help out your other lanes massively. Like getting rid of that precision aura being buffed up all across the board. So I would certainly agree that that would be the play. And the only issue might be what's gonna happen with Shashlo, because in that solo safe lane, I feel like the Nature's Prophet is just gonna be able to destroy him if that's what ends up happening here.
Yeah.
It'll be a lot of soul ring action probably happening in like tranquils and like hiding under his own tower.
Exactly. It's not gonna be the easiest of places to be in. I know it is not a nice game to be the offlane Earthshaker, but it's the same can be said for the Nature's Prophet, right? Oracle does wonders against that hero. If both teams might decide actually that aggro try is in their favor, just because of how squishy their offlaners are and how easy to catch out.
Yeah, we definitely could see some musical lanes here because Vega, they I would assume would want to dodge. Like Disruptor, he's kind of like okay in he's okay in like dual lane situations where it's like duo on duo, but when it comes to like the try on try, he does kind of fall off quite a bit. He's pretty weak. So Ventral Spirit as well, you only have the single magic missile. Yeah, the minus armor is good when you're like the favorable tri lane, like if you feel like you're still better than that other tri, but I think that the HR tri lane would be better. Just with everything that they're providing and offering, like the long range where the fortunes end, and they can just kind of run at you. And what are you going to do? Like, you'll have to skill up into the gust early on. And Disruptor, like, Glimpse only works on one hero, and the range is not going to be enough early on into the game. Like, you need those levels on Seema.
There is something to be said though for if HR are able sorry, if Vega are able to just pound away at a hero, obviously with a Drow aura, they have a nice advantage there. I think a lot of it's just gonna come down to positioning, and anybody in either of these tri lanes, if they do end up running into each other, anybody out of position is getting punished. Drow can't stand up to a reality rift from the Chaos Knight with that type of support. So it'll just remain to be seen. Why is Solo claiming that he is sponsored by Nitrogen? What? What? I don't think that's how that works.
Dude, he's on a whole other level, man.
Yeah,
He's
this
turbo all the time. That's why.
yeah. I don't always know what's going on. I love how people can just add in whatever tags. I thought that that second tag spot was meant to be, mostly for team sponsors, but
Oh yeah, it
a
is,
lot of
but
them just use it for fun things. I do wonder what's up with this Nitrogen here. Solo Nitrogen. I don't know. I do not know.
there's an energy drink here called Nitro. Maybe he just really likes
I
energy
know.
drinks.
What are we? I don't know if they're called nitros, but the beers where you can the ciders or the beers you can get where it fizzes the other way. You have
Nope.
no idea what I'm talking about, do you? I don't know. I don't drink much. I'm not hip, guys. I'm not terribly
Damn.
hip. Yeah. So either way, we're still paused. Just taking a look around. We're Alpha Ninja here. For me, this is kind of one of the deciding factors. He's up against a Viper.
Yes.
It's not going to be it's not going to be a fun lane.
No.
What does he
awful.
Need to get out of it to have his team not be like? Because that's to me what's most boring. If this puck is completely shut down, that super delays the blink timing. It super delays a lot of what HR have to deal with the push. What does he need to get out of this mid lane?
The issue with puck lately, it's but some teams have been seeing a ton of success with puck. You know, you pick the hero, you win your lane, and you just dominate the map. Like, the hero can just completely spiral control. There are squishy heroes on the side of Vega. They didn't draft anything too crazy besides the Vipers, so there will be that potential that if he gets up to a fast, like, level 9, 10, you can go around and just blow up the support, the Disruptor, the Vengeful Spirit, even the Drow Ranger, of course. But the issue is going to be you lose so much of your utility in the lane right now for Alpha Ninja. You have zero chance of your supports coming in to help. Like, the only possible rotation you might get is, like, Shasho gets forced out of lane and ends up walking home to Fountain and TPing mid. That's, like, the best possible rotation that's going to happen. You get a Fissure block on the Viper, and maybe you get a kill without dying to Corrosive Skin. Other than that, he can't use the orb to farm, because he's going to need it to either control the runes or just run away. The rotations can come in at any moment from Meg, so you waste an orb on something that's not escape, and Meg's just going to show up and, like, dominate you with the poison attack, slowing you down the whole way. Phase shift will not save you. So it's certainly an uphill battle for Alpha Ninja. He could be the real deciding factor here, and it's gonna be really hard. Like, if he loses this lane massively, it really can't even be put on him, because he is being put into an awful position right now.
Yeah, there aren't a lot. I mean, as you said, there's a lot of work that needs to be done here to stop the early push lineup from coming. Also, if HR's lucky, Vega will overextend and make a mistake. But Vega, I believe, doing a lot better in this tournament. Let me actually just pull that up. Vega currently sitting at 11-2. Oh, actually, this is Vega's last match. It does not matter if they win or lose this one. They can only be caught by Na'Vi. And that's if Na'Vi win the rest of the remaining matches. And if Vega wins, they just are in. Okay! Not nearly as much on the line, suddenly, as I checked that. I knew Vega were top, but I did not. I had not done the maths. Hellraisers are 1-7 as well so far in this WePlay League. So, I'm just saying, Vega, they can kind of do whatever they want here. Worst case scenario, they are in tiebreakers, and that's only if Na'Vi wins every single match.
Yeah, well, it still looks like with this draft, they're playing to win. Like, if you take any sort of advantage early on as Vega, the Roshan is just destroyed. Like, you have no hope of taking this on the side of HR. You do not have the heroes for it at all. You probably don't have to worry about HR grabbing it for, like, 18 minutes or something. It would be, like, the first time they even have the damage to take care of it. So it's always just going to be this backup plan for Vega. Let's say that somehow, you know, the lanes do go bad. Maybe they, you know, don't quite get the kills on the Drow. It looks like the Drow's gonna be fine up top, but, you know, maybe there's some rotations come in, they get Pasha a couple times, then they can just kind of recover with the Roshan. They don't even have that much AoE, like, there won't be a Blink Dagger on the Earthshaker. Maybe you'll run into some issues with the puck, but Roshan's pretty free this game.
Yeah, now, they are trying to have the Nature's Prophet reposition the creep wave to somewhere where he would, like, he's going to get what he wants out here, I think. Oh, actually, what are the creeps doing? No, he's going to get exactly what he wants. Even
this
Illidan.
Is brutal.
Yeah.
This Illidan. Mid lane.
Oh, mid lane? What's... Okay. Yeah, oh.
Tolo's just here training him. Like, Alpha Ninja hasn't even gotten... He's missed out on so many creeps already.
I mean, it's not an easy thing to play on, even though you mentioned Alpha Ninja. He's very familiar with this here. Actually, taking the stun.
Oh,
Venge has a lot of damage because of that Drow aura. One more isn't able to get it, and the Tango up would have made it need two hits, so... Alpha Ninja, though, we can already see if this Venge just gets a little bit more mana, suddenly Alpha Ninja in a world of hurt. Up top as well, Sharklaw taking so much harass from Seema. Welcome to Drowland.
This, like, they already have the Disruptor sitting mid, using the kinetic field, trying to snipe out the courier. That didn't quite work out. Solo still sitting mid. Got kind of lucky on the fact that the orb was skilled up there by Alpha Ninja. He didn't quite know, but he threw out the magic missile and was correct in that fact, so... Oh man, this is so brutal. I actually feel for Alpha Ninja so bad right now because it was already a hard lane, and now it's looking almost impossible.
Yeah, he is down 10 CS. There is not looking like there's much easy way to get back into this game. The Viper is soon going to be about half a level up on him. And yeah, he has support rotations, but Viper, a notoriously hard hero to bring down. Although, as I say that, he doesn't have any points in the Corrosive Skin yet. And the support rotation coming in. Smoked up. They're gonna have a nice Fortune's End coming out. There it goes. Fortune's End flying out. They managed to do a little bit of heal damage. The casket does come out still. No points in that. Oh, 1 point in that corrosive skin. They're gonna get themselves the first blood. And now Vega coming in, trying to get the return kill onto YW. We'll see if he can get it. He needs a few more auto attacks, but the Voodoo Restoration too strong. And Afa Ninja looking to get himself some more. Unable.
Alright, so this is, like, perfect scenario, right? You do manage to get the rotation kill in, even though you don't have the most aggressive supports, but just for the fact that they didn't go the aggro try with Illidan, it does allow this to happen, so they've completely zoned up the Nature's Prophet. Didn't block off this camp, but you can see Goddamn knows exactly what's going on. He's even got the Sentry to try it. So we might see him be able to block that off, but Afa Ninja, oh no, he's gonna die the poison attack! Fairy Fire! Whew! Big save, big save.
Yeah, he is still having a really rough time. Even with that early kill, he is still well behind the Viper when it comes to CS and farm. It's not looking great. And also, the Earth Spirit up top, Earth Shaker up top, I need to drink this tea. He is getting heavily pressured. The Venge was actually going for the wraparound when she came back towards mid, because there was some trouble in little Midtown.
Yeah, and this is before Seaman. Like, he hasn't even either skilled up Glimpse or the Thunderstrike. So he still has both options available. If they see a kill potential coming out, there isn't even the early point of the Frost Arrow, so Pasha can just keep stacking this aura. Might grab it if the Earthshaker shows back up, or could even just hold on to it, because if you don't need it, like, why bother grabbing it, honestly? Like, no one's in your lane, so just farm away and help out everyone else with your aura. And I like that Solo's rotated down here. We all know that Solo is probably the greediest support left, maybe besides Funnik, in terms of, like, the overall professional scene. He loves split pushing with Shadow Shaman, with Lina, and he'll take any opportunity like this to soak up EXP on a side lane if his offlaner is forced out.
Now, what is... I feel like both teams, they've dodged the offlanes because there's so much early aggression. Where do you think things are going to break out next? Because we are not going to be seeing it in either of the safe lanes just due to people dodging. And as I say that, there is a little rune fight. Ends up working out for both parties. So
it'll probably be HR trying to make a play on top of Pasha. Like... this is pretty... Shasha's like Iron Towning Earthshaker. This is brutal, but he needs to get a couple levels up, and they need to go on this drow. You likely won't see the same thing come out on top of the Earthshaker, or rather on top of the Chaos Knight, because he's just too scary, I think. Like, just throw out a stun, run away. They even have this nice ward here, keeping him safe. And top lane will be where the action is. Goddamn's already there, but perhaps, like, if Afa Ninja can ever get up to level 6, he could show up there. And other than that, it'll just have to be Fisher into Cask.
Yeah,
but that's definitely the prime target.
There's not a lot of opportunities opening themselves up yet. Pasha is taking quite a bit of harass. They actually put up a really nice ward up here, so if there's any chance that Pasha is low, maybe they'll be able to rotate folks in and get the kill. But Pasha does have a lot of support around, and also Seema getting levels from doing stacked creeps with the help of pulling.
I'm so scared for Goddamn right now. I'm just like watching the Dire Vision to see if he accidentally peeks.
I don't think he'll make that mistake. This is kind of... we see this a lot, right? With the players,
yeah.
They're always finding
you hiding.
It's just
so scary with this little... yeah, it'll just DP it, just in case.
And actually, Solo just used the Howl, the Wave of Terror, on the creeps there, and, like, if it had been used elsewhere, maybe it would have been really bad for Goddamn. But either way, he's now just back up top, still getting a lot of experience. He's gonna be level 4. That's pretty dang good for a support.
Yeah, Shasha's just, like, rotating back up, like, please, I need this. I'm so poor. I'm Iron Talon Earthshaker.
Yeah, it's not looking great for him. He's gonna work on that camp some, it looks like it, after he regens up. Maybe just gonna end up fissuring it out, but still across the board getting some good levels on HR. And you can see they're starting to pull a little bit ahead when it comes to experience.
I wonder what kind of a build you even go on Shashlo now. Like, can you really... you've already committed 500 gold towards the Iron Talon. Now, it seems like the Blink Dagger is just so far away that you would have to go for, like, Tranquils and Soul Ring to actually be effective by the time that aggression actually comes out.
I think you can definitely still build the Blink. It really depends on how these engagements go, right? I imagine he'll save up some gold, probably get Brown Boots, save up some gold, see what happens. If he can get involved in a couple kills, suddenly the Blink is much more manageable of an item.
Yeah, a lot of it comes down to the vision that Vega's gonna get, because if they start warding up this jungle, or, like, even this offlane camp, then the rotations in for Meg can just be instant death with the precision aura. He's so strong. Like, already plus 29 damage, and he can show up in any lane and hit for 100 and almost 20.
Yeah, he is hitting like a truck. Now, down bottom, they've started to pressure the tower some. As Illidan realizing that there is nobody about, he can kind of do what he wants. Do you expect an early omelet out of this fellow, since he's in a super uncontested lane?
Yeah, probably just, like, treads, drums, armlet. No major rush on the armlet, honestly, until you have the second point in the Phantasm. It's not too crazy required. Just drums offer so much to your hero. Like, the attack speed obviously always can be sick when you have such a great crit. So just tank up a little bit. It's going to be hard up against the Viper, right? So the move speed, every little bit helps. And then by the time your Phantasm's ready, your armlet's ready, and you can just kind of go to battle.
Wow, and Viper,
crazy. No boots.
Yeah, no boots. Mech finished. Full maxed out corrosive skin. He is taking no chances here.
That's, man, this mech, there is no way. Like, you see another rotation come in mid? There's no way. Like, you can bring those three heroes back again. Not gonna die. Mag will come in and clean it up.
Like,
Solo's dead top.
You can pretty much Echo Slam him. Either way, yeah, Nitrogen gonna go down. And nice pickup there. And that's exactly what they wanted this ward for. Knew that that was a solo support. They managed to get themselves something. And that is sure gonna help out Oathshaker. Suddenly, Shocklow, Arcane's looking like they're in reach.
Yeah, and this ward just not quite helping out there. Well, maybe it did in one sense, simply because, like, you lost solo, but Pasha's just freely farming the jungle. As long as he doesn't die, they really do not care.
Shocklow gonna take the Thunder Strike. Now he's going back in. He does not have Echo Slam yet. Pasha doing a lot of damage. They go for the TP, but this is ambitious, to say the least, and he's gonna fall. And now in mid, no one applying a bit more pressure to Alpha Ninja.
Bottom lane, at least, you know, Illidan. He's still farming away. He's getting a little bit of pressure on the tower, but not exactly the heavy push hero that you're typically looking at. Maybe when the drums come out, that'll help out enough with the push. But the counter push top, like, we already know, it's Death Ball. They can easily take Roshan at any point now. Like, no question whatsoever. Zero possibility of contest. No Death Ward, no Echo Slam with the blink. It's completely free for them whenever they'd like it.
Do you think you go for the Rosh super early? I mean, obviously it seems like the right play. Oh, they're actually just going to try to find a Slay up on top, really wanting to delay this Earthshaker. This is going to be a hard one, though. There they go. They've got the stun coming out. Yeah, and they have Glimpse. There is no way out of here for Shocklow. They have full vision of him, glimpsing him backwards into his death. So quick pick with the smoke. And as you said, they could just transition into Roshan already, and there won't be much time for HR to respond.
Yeah, honestly, they can just keep this push up. It looks like they don't want to risk it, just not having quite enough vision, so Meg will just go farm it up, but the towers right now are also still free, so you can just take down those outer objectives first. If you don't feel like you need the Roshan now, there's not too much of a rush. It's just they have so many options right now, and so whatever they want to achieve on the map right now is essentially theirs. I think a kill onto Illidan should be prioritized soon, though, because they have the tools for it. Like, with the points up into the Glimpse now, a smoke down there would see a great benefit to Vega.
Yeah, you mentioned being concerned that Illidan will get out of control this match and just be able to, you know, if he's allowed to farm for 30 minutes or so, suddenly come out and be nigh unkillable. They do have good mechanisms for kiting him, though, on Vega. Do you think that won't be enough, especially with Phantasm?
It certainly will help. Like,
you just face-checked Roche. Like, that is that is, you
some
should
risky
get
business.
Like, that is not, I think, the play you do with your solo carry roaming around. But okay, you were saying about Illidan.
It's tough. Like, he gets really crazy at, like, 30 minutes, but for the next 20 minutes or so, it shouldn't be too much concern. A lot of it still comes down to Alpha Ninja, right? Like, he has to actually be controlling them that, yes, they can kite out Illidan, but if someone else is holding them in place, that's when you get this massive reality rift into a Phantasm nuke, so just keep farming up on Shoshlo, keep farming up on top of Alpha Ninja. If this Blink Dagger can get built here by Shoshlo, it's because they still haven't put any vision in the jungle, so he can still just keep this Iron Talon business up.
Yeah, they do not actually have fantastic... Oh, actually, one more expires. Up top, though, we're going to have a pullback onto Illidan. Oh, gosh, Illidan is killing off solo again, looking like they'll get this. A nice little pick there for the Chaos Knight, helping to accelerate his farm. It looks like she swapped into that. I was super... No, it was Reality Rift, of course. Never mind.
Yeah, she got whooped.
Yeah. In bottom, though, the push is coming. They are setting up defenses. They still do not have the Death Ward yet on Witch Doctor. Very close. Illidan actually uses his ult. He's going to go in. He wants to find someone to kill off here. There's a nice Reality Rift and the stun. Mag going down. Doesn't matter if you have the Silence on Pasha. Coconut Bounce is not quite exactly where they want them, but Illidan, he's already done good work. And there it is, the Dream Coil. Death Ward now being dropped. Got level 6 from that. A swap in. I don't think that's where you want it to be, though, Solo. And no one finally brought down. They had to exert everything. Drowd needs one more hit onto Illidan. Isn't able to get it, but they do catch out the Earthshaker. Stun now onto Goddamn. Can they find anything to Coconuts? It doesn't matter if that's a beautiful Static Storm. They just don't have the damage from lack of auto attacks due to the stuns. And a really nice set there by HR, getting Illidan out on what looked to be sub 50 health. Big win for them.
is under attack.
Gotta say, I'm not a big fan of the no points into the Frost Arrow. I think they could have had two more kills there with one of those attribute points put into Frost Arrows. Not, I mean, I understand this was like more old school, but it has been falling off, and I think for a good reason. Like, there's way more engagements early on now that I think that one lost point is going to offer you way more in terms of the slow. But that's okay.
Yeah, and when I mentioned good ways to deal with Illidan and so on, I really was referring to kiting, right? You have slow, you have the Viper Strike, you also have Poison Attack. These are all excellent methods for dealing with someone like Illidan, as long as you can identify the right one, and at some point the illusions kill you anyway, but you have tools to keep their heroes in a lot of trouble. But instead, HR, they do manage to get that kill. Arcane's up on the Earthshaker. They're also thinking about contesting the Roshan. They're going to be too little too late. And Puck deciding not to go in. They're still all here for HR, smoked up. Coconuts do end up coming out. Shockler going to follow up with a Fissure, but it looks like that'll be the end of the engagement. And Puck just running on by. Alpha Ninja wants nothing to do with this business. Very close to his blink.
Oh man, they're going to lose every tower. Like, going for this, the Arcane Boots on top of Shosh, though, I can understand it because he went down, like, even though he got the Echo Slam kill in the bottom lane, but if you don't have this Blink Dagger, all your towers are completely forfeit. The only way you're going to get a good Echo Slam is, like, a Dream Coil and you run down from the high ground. That's essentially it. I don't think you have anything else to offer here as this Earthshaker. It's just going to be Fissures.
And as you
so
say that,
they can't contest.
Ooh, and he throws out a Fissure, but he's still in range of the Corrosive Skin. That wasn't great for him. And, yeah, they're just gonna go for the push. It looks like HR may be thinking about exchanging, but, of course, Witch Doctor not gonna push nearly as hard as the entire five-man from Vega with a Drow. Middle tower is under
attack. Oh, man. This is just Drow. This is a Drow strat. It's working out. Even when you're down in kills like this, it just doesn't matter.
I mean, yeah, they're 5k net worth ahead. They're actually ahead on the experience, despite grouping up. If you're Vega, do you think the game plan is try to take all the outer towers, wait for the next Roshan before you go, or do you feel that there's a bit more pressure that they need to get high ground since they're on somewhat of a timer facing a Chaos Knight?
They're definitely on a timer, but their timer doesn't expire for, like, almost 20 minutes at this point just because of how, like, underfarmed the Puck and the Earthshaker are, so... You just close out these towers. They really need the vision, and they're starting it now. Like, you've got this nice aggressive piece. They already have one over here in the jungle, and that's just going to open it up for Meg, because now his role is not so much the split pushing on the sides. You want to leave that to your supports. You want to get, like, a roaming solo into a kill. Like, you want to be picking off these people, because they need to fire them up on the side of Hellraisers. You know there's going to be lone heroes in the jungle, just like right now, like Shoshlo. You need to be picking these guys off. Goddamn, can't be allowed to fire him down here right now. Like, that's not okay. So once these towers get closed out, that's when you can start applying this pressure. And top lane looks like the next target.
Goddamn is very good at that. Like, he is being incredibly sneaky this game, managing to get farm out of the map where I really wasn't expecting it. And he is already level 9, which, considering where the state of the game is, right, he's right up there. He's higher level than the Nature's Prophet.
Yeah, what else tends to happen in these Drow pushes, it's, you know, little comical things like that, so they just split the experience so much. But yeah, he really has been, like, he took over the offlane for a while when Shasha was jungling, and he's kind of doing what your typical solo role is, where he just split pushes these side lanes. And these levels are really helpful, like, you need them so badly on Oracle, and it might help them in these engagements, but it's going to be relying on Illidan. He's so close to level 11, but the armlet is still far away. And that's, like, their next real engagement point. It's like Blink, Dream Coil, armlet, Phantasm.
Okay, they're
two.
Catching out. Goddamn, he is stuck here. Uses that False Promise. Does have a TP on him. The swap is still up, so he knows he can't go for that, and he is going to fall here. No way that his heal was outpacing that damage. I also wanted to point out that Drow has gone for a Dragon Lance, not the super common pickup we see on any hero, really.
Yeah, I've seen a couple of these lately, you know, a couple ODs, but the Drow's been pretty popular over in SEA. It's a solid item. I mean, you know you're going to be looking for the Butterfly eventually. He's already getting the Mithril Hammer for his BKB, so just going to chill with it for a little bit. It helps out with the Tower Siege as well, so you can actually apply your damage in a slightly safer position. It honestly, like, every inch makes a difference with the Vengeful Spirit involved, right? So just, like, the further back you can be with the swap.
Every inch makes a difference. I'm going to quote you on that sometime in the future, Mott Packs, inappropriately and out of context. But in the meantime, we're going to be seeing the next push come on, and this is the last tier 2 going down. They do still have a minute on that Aegis, so they'll probably I doubt they'll poke at high ground, but they've got options here. Even if Vega, they take a little stumble, there's still a long ways to go before HL's back in this thing. They need 900 gold before they have a blink on Echo, blink Echo coming out.
All right, Shoshua, you gotta run into this man.
Avaninja needs to settle all up. He's got that move speed until he's visible. Let's see if they can do it. We're going to be seeing... Oh, a nice pick onto the Disruptor. This should not be a Static Storm. Dreamcrow comes out onto two of them. They do manage to Static Storm nothing, really. But Choclo, he gets off the Echo Slam. It does get one kill. Can they find more? No one immediately brought down on the sidelines. And now Solo taking a lot of damage here as well. They immediately kill off the Oracle. And this Chaos Knight, he is ripping right through their lines. Can he find Pasha here? Pasha does go down. That is life number one. But with only a Nature's Prophet around, it's looking like life number two will be forfeit as well. Stun comes out. And suddenly Pasha looking to be going down, and that was the exact fight that Aton needed.
Yeah, I'm not sure if they saw the armlet, and that might have been the issues that they smoked up with like level 11 and armlet without Vega knowing, because they did commit pretty heavily for that. And yeah, it's exactly what happens, man. You turn on that armlet, pop that level 2 phantasm, and go to work. So they got exactly what they needed. Got some nice little spells being thrown out there. Yeah, some good initiation. Pretty impressive that Shasha managed to get off that Echo Slam, honestly. Like, he was just like mashing R and running in there. So hopefully he can get himself up to the Blink Dagger and HR can start to turn this thing around for their side. And for the side of Vega, though, you know, you just closed out the last tower. You're not too disappointed, but you always have to be cautious with these early Death Ball strats, because it's when you overcommit. Obviously, it's the only way that you can really lose. So next Roshan will be key. They're going to have the tools by then to fight it from the side of HR. So again, it's just this vision. They need to know if HR are going to be contesting the next Roshan and if Shasha is going to have the Blink Dagger for it.
Yeah, I think it's entirely possible. I actually did not see what the Roshan spawn timer was. I didn't see that pop out. It's entirely possible Shocklow has the Blink Dagger. He's getting very close, albeit he didn't survive that last engagement, but he wasn't put too far further behind where he was. So he's close. And also, Puck has the blink up. I think the real menace that you mentioned already is the Chaos Knight. Illidan still farming well, despite his team being super far behind. He is second on the net worth.
Yeah, it's true. It's just, he's getting all the space. Like, Illidan's so good at this. We all know this. You know, it's impressive enough when he does it on any mage and Morphling, but, it's even more impressive though when it's on something like a Chaos Knight. Can they find Avaninja down here? It's gonna be close.
Yeah, they already used the Wave of Terror, and Avaninja, I think they just saw that he jaunted somewhere, but I'm not sure.
Yeah, they're pinging right there. Nice
point. He's got the TP. But they knew he was there, but missed him. He did a nice job with the phase shift, making it so that the Wave of Terror didn't see him.
They have the Vlad stun for Solo, so he is gearing up for this. You know, they know what their lineup is, right? You just build these aura items, get a Glimmer Cape up on your Disruptor. It's all about these mid-game kind of tier items. And then once his BKB comes up on Pasha, it's a great item up against the Echo Slam, but if Illidan can get on top of him with the Phantasm, that can completely, like, eliminate any chance of a win for them, honestly.
Oh, but they're going in onto Illidan. They managed to get the Sprout out. Illidan also being glimpsed backwards into a Static Storm.
So close.
No ult coming out from this Chaos Knight, and they managed to bring him down.
Oh, that would have been so sick if he dodged it with that. It's so hard to time, though. It's, like, impossible, honestly.
I mean, I wouldn't be surprised. He's going the Manta because that's what you do on a Chaos Knight, but I wouldn't be surprised if he ends up having to use that, as you said, in an attempt to dodge the glimpse. But this is great for Vega. They've put themselves in a good spot for pushing. The BKB is actually at the ready for the Drow. I'm not sure. She might actually be going Dragon Lance and BKB. I'm a little surprised.
If you're just pushing like this, I think it's fine to just hold on to the Dragon Lance.
Drums are popped. This tower already at half health. They should be able to bring it down before Illidan respawns, although 9 seconds, he'll have a TP in or whatever he wants, and suddenly they have to be a little bit careful on Vega, but they'll tower and back immediately out. Interesting. Sprout, not quite sure what that was about. Avaninja coming forward with the haste, manages to get the Drink Coil onto one. Solo taking a lot of damage. Pasha actually caught in it as well. No one comes over to pop that mech, but here comes Illidan working his way onto Pasha. Echo Slam as well. They do send back Illidan, so he's not wrecking through their lines, but he catches Pasha again. Reality Rift gonna bring down the Drow, and now suddenly Solo again in trouble. They're going for the back lines, though. They want the bigger targets. They want this Nature's Prophet. Illidan will take who he can get in Solo, but Mag in a lot of trouble. Caught up there in his own Sprout. A stun comes out from Illidan,
nice,
as does the Fissure. And now Mag, no chance to escape. There's a Maledict as well. They don't even need it. Reality Rift finishes him off. Solo in a lot of trouble in the lines. They're still chasing him. The heal coming out, helping him from the Oracle. But Solo still being chased out. Oh, what? Avaninja just stops there. Static Storm dropped right on top of their head. He's going to get healed up by his ally here. Back comes no one trying to get back involved in this business. Illidan's still standing and fighting. They should be able to bring him down here with nether toxin. Oh, he gets the ult that toggles off, and Seema's still in a lot of trouble. He's glimpsed backwards, and now no one finally brings down Illidan. Can no one stand and fight this one? We'll see what he can do here. Afaninjay stuck purposely in the trees, and I think that'll be the end of that. But again, a dominant fight by HR.
Yeah, Afaninja played that entire fight so unbelievably well. Like, he cast all his spells and then was just right-clicking Pasha, and Pasha threw out the silence, despite everything being on cooldown already from Afaninja, which just meant that Shasha was able to just walk on in, get his Echo Slam off. You know, there was no sort of a counter play there. They got the great chase down, and Vega, they played it right, right? Like, they got the tower, they saw Illidan respawning, and they started to back, but it was just too late up against the puck. And yeah, the haste rune, a big part of that, it did allow him to close the gap way faster than they were expecting. So that's kind of what tipped off that whole engagement. But again, it's just overcommitment, making a mistake, and just wanting that tower so bad that it was long enough to Illidan to come back up. Now, fortunately, he did die, which is huge for them. They really needed that one kill.
Unfortunately, though, that was an entire fight without Death Ward being used. That wasn't even HR's final form. So they're in a lot of trouble here. They don't know that the Roche is up. They should check it again shortly, but it was a little bit earlier. It popped up right as no one left. And this does give HR time to go for it. They don't have any smokes in stock, but they do have one on the Witch Doctor. So here it goes. They also could take the Roche, potentially, although I don't think either team too interested in fighting in the Roche on pit. Oh, they picked up the Invis rune. Vega has to have seen that. They don't... The drawing on the map, I am not sure if Vegas were watching for the Invis rune.
Yeah, it looks like they know. Just the way they're grouping up as five, you know, staying in this kind of positioning where you're behind the tower and the trees and everything. So they should be aware, like, this is what HR need, right? They need to keep the momentum up, keep getting these ganks, these pickoffs. But maybe not. Like, this is some risky positioning coming out. You've got to know.
Oh gosh, they've already used the Phantasm. Illidan going in, ripping right on through solo. They do get a Static Storm off, but it is not enough. Illidan swap back in. Can they bring him down? They need to. They finally do. A beautiful Dream Crew on the Echo Slam coming out from Shockglow. Manages to hit on two. Seema trying to kite him while he can. Yolo Warrior standing up on that high ground, fighting against no one. Can no one get the kills? Beautiful Coconuts, but it's not looking like it's enough. And Vega finally take a fight. It's looking like they will get out of that one unscathed. And now it's time for Drow to do what she does best, soloing Roshan, and the base is pushing in.
That was pretty scary. Like, you commit the Static Storm just on top of Illidan, but honestly, it's worth it. Like, yeah, you don't catch Afaninja inside, but simply the mech aura basically keeping everyone alive at the end of that engagement, and everything got thrown out. There was an Echo Slam, there was a Fissure. They really got everything that they could have ever dreamed of getting during that fight, but just not enough damage, honestly. Like, if you can't get a quick pickoff on the Pasha, then they're just going to shred right through you. So now you're going to lose this Aegis. The Aghanim Scepter, also from Meg, is going to be really big coming to this next probably like 10 minutes or so. Simply because, like, we know Illidan's on the Chaos Knight. He's been doing a great job of split pushing, but you can only do so much. Like, it's a Chaos Knight, you know? You don't have a Battle Fury or anything like that.
Also, I think a really fantastic job on Vega of isolating out the Chaos Knight there. The Static Storm, he actually managed to get out of it because it didn't quite catch him on the edge, and he got a Reality Rift, and Solo said, nope, you're coming back in here with his swap. Also, Seema able to use Glimpse and so on to help out. It just really well played there from Vega, understanding that's the target they need to isolate. Of course, high ground defense is still really good from Vega, and by the time it comes around, I'm actually not sure if Echo will be up.
It's close. It likely, by the time they can actually push it, it depends if they have any items. Doesn't look like anything too crazy. Possibly, like, Pasha, like, 2400 gold. He'll probably just save it for the next big item in case the next push doesn't go too well. Oh, this BKB from no one, 10-second duration, is going to be extremely difficult to deal with. And thanks to having the Aghanim Scepter, of course, Mag is just rich now. Just throwing out all the gold, last hits. And he can go into whatever he'd like. He'd go for, like, the Blink, or just start building into his own Octarine Core. Even picking up a Necro Book would fit really well with their timing, even though it's not the most common item right now.
Yeah, I think in this lineup it makes a lot of sense. Also, something that the HR, they have a lot of AoE damage. Maybe you accidentally kill the Necro Book with an Echo Slam, and suddenly this Earthshaker going down to that. But Pasha just going to play up. They have pressure, ability to pressure all the lanes with the Nature's Prophet's Nature's Wrath. Here comes the Reality Rift in onto Pasha. Fissure,
nice Fissure,
keeping him in there. There's going to be a nice Phantasm, but the swap out, Pasha's going to be fine. Death Ward used completely on solo. Do you back out without your Venge?
Yes, they need to leave right now. Like, okay. This is the one hope now for HR. And they hesitated a little bit there, but it looks like they will get out, so.
Yeah, they
good play, gonna save the ages. Plenty of time left, so that's worth it for them, honestly. But it's still a good hold from HR, definitely advantage them. And the more I think about this for Meg, I really have no idea what he's going to go for. Like, there's so many good items right now. He could go for an AC to help out their push. He could go for the Orchid still, because really, like, either shutting down Alpha Ninja or Shasha is going to be massive. Even the Death Ward, even the Oracle. I think Orchid might actually be the pickup here. Or it's still the Necro Book. Like, it's very, I think, personal dependent on, like, how your team feels like they can take these fights. I don't think there's a really clear answer.
They are picking up a Veil on this Disruptor. I was not expecting that.
Good item choice. Not the most magical damage, but it is just more about this whole timing. It's just the fact that you're probably not ever going to get into the Aghanim Scepter if you win this game, really. Like, if they don't win in the next, like, there is still a timer. They don't win in the next 12 minutes or so-ish. Things do look pretty bad here, unless they're, like, consistently winning every single engagement.
Now they're coming in for this next team fight. We'll have to see how it goes. Putting up them buybacks, as we can see, there are two up on HR. So if this goes south for them, they've got some options, but already their range strikes. Oh, goodness, Drow just ripping on through it. Doesn't even bother to finish it off. Pasha still has the Aegis. Goddamn, doing a lot of harass. She's brought down to half health. Glimmer Cape, she's gonna be seen because there's a sentry there. She throws out the silence onto Illidan, and again, this rack's down at half health. Fortune's End gonna be coming out onto Pasha. There is no defense yet. Shocklow does have Echo Slam and Blink, but there's just not a good target. Reality Rift in onto Pasha. Shocklow could have gone for it, still being very patient, and it's looking like they're just gonna lose the racks. But there are the coconuts coming out, they're bouncing around. Oh, there's the Echo Slam, manages to hit onto 4, and Shocklow doing good work. Pasha already popped the BKB, pretty death, and now no one taking a lot of damage from that Death Ward. They've managed to kill off the Earthshaker already in the Static Storm. They swap back Alpha Ninja, he's gonna manage to jaunt away. Chaos Knight has to buy back into this game, that's one expended, but Yolo Warrior already taking too much damage, and the burst from Alpha Ninja, not enough. He's gonna pop in that Fortune's End. They might be able to bring down Pasha here, but that is just life number one. And Chaos Knight, he's got the Phantasm out. Let's see if he can find some more. Pasha immediately throwing out that silence, trying to just run it out. The dust hit on her. She's invisible, so taking extra move speed debuff. And now the glimpse backwards, meaning that Illidan not gonna be able to get in range for a while. Alpha Ninja still coming. Mag going for the TP out. Pasha caught again. No one could come in here and help out, but the mech is on cooldown for 17 seconds. Pasha gonna be jaunted in front of, tries to throw out the silence, isn't quite able to, and Alpha Ninja may just be the one who ends up bringing Pasha down. Blink forwards, there's gonna be the silence, and one more auto attack against Drow's mega kill streak, and now no one in the hot seat. Reality Rift back, and he's going. Oh, the swap in isn't gonna save his life. Manages to buy time for the mech. The reality, the phantasms are gone. Illidan still chasing, the ult comes out from Nate. Oh, he manages to dodge it! Not enough. But Viper almost escaping, and now actually Alpha Ninja may pay with this for his life. There goes the Veil coming out. Invisibility used by Seema the Slayer with that Glimmer Cape. Illidan taking a bit of damage here. The Static Storm hits onto 3, and now Mag just standing there and fighting. He doesn't have Nature's Wrath again, and now with the Death Ward going around and the coconuts bouncing, a lot of trouble. The Glimpse manages to stop the Death Ward. Goddamn, taking damage heavily here. He's gonna get healed back up though, and Mag also has sacrificed his life. Illidan still chasing under tower. There's gonna be a kinetic field to try and stop. Oh, Disruptor actually Seema just wants to go in on this. They are just buying time for the creeps ripping through the base here. And that finally will be the end of things.
Man, that was like the most value Morbid Mask I think I've ever seen in Dota 2. Unbelievable how long Pasha was able to sit on the high ground and just completely decimate them. And it turns out, you know, pretty good fight for HR, but again, they didn't engage until after the Rax was down. And although it's hard to find that perfect positioning, and Vega did a really good job of not grouping up. And so by the time they were grouped up and you saw that great Echo Slam and Dream Coil, the Rax was already down. But it just feels like one Rax, yeah, okay, we can let that one slide. But if that happens again and this superior positioning is still coming out, they need to find a better solution. Like, they need to, I don't know if it means smoking out and trying to get a fight outside the base, but it was very clear that even with the Death Ward, Puck, Echo Slam, they just don't have the tools to deal with what Vega are putting out here in terms of this high ground push. Like, they can't seem to get on top of who they need to.
Yeah, there are also just some simple positioning solutions that you mentioned. When Pasha has that Aegis, he's playing way further up than the rest of his team. So it's just difficult for HR to find anything too good. But they do have the Manta style up on Illidan. And at this point in the game, Illidan will be ripping on through everything he touches. So if they get a small window, HR can easily start taking down two towers in a lane. Maybe even down to the tier 3.
Well, And once again, that time. Check out the clock. One more minute till we find out. Shorter spawn, obviously going to be favoring the side of Vega.
Mag already has a refresher orb. We were talking about what is he going to build with all of that extra gold he's getting from pressing R. He goes for a refresher. And this actually has been decimating them in teamfights.
Yeah, he bought a Maelstrom and then he sold it during the window and just decided for the refresher instead. So just probably just from the fact that they were going to get the Rax gold and everything like that. So that is going to be pretty brutal. Now they'll need, of course, the high ground vision. And typically he is hanging pretty far back, so should be okay.
Tenacious Wrath does come out, going to pressure all of the lanes here. And they will not actually send the creeps to do stuff. How do you feel for Pasha? Yeah, Drow Ranger ends up keeping both the Black King Bar and the Dragon Lance. Do you eventually disassemble this? And by eventually, I mean after the Boots of Travel that I imagine will be coming out next, or even just picking up a butterfly next. What do you think is the play here from Drow?
I mean, when you get into like 6 slot of territory, you can disassemble it, but if you want the butterfly next, I think you just keep the Dragonlance, honestly. Like, the 900 gold is totally worth it. You're not going to really have anything else to use that Black King, or the Ogre Club with anyway. So, you're just going to be getting a lot of value out of it. The extra range, it's just so good with the swap. Like, you can already see Pasha's, like, outside of tower range when he's sieging, so again, it's going to be helping out pretty heavily with these two other lanes.
It is a very short Roshan respawn timer, and Dire are going to know all about it. Helm of the Dominator tipping them off to that. So, not looking like there's too much to stop Vega from pushing on forwards. Viper has got himself up a plate mail. Could go for Shivas or AC. Not even sure it matters a super large amount. They're in a really good spot here for Vega.
Yeah, someone had to pick up the AC, so he can snag that up. Help accelerate their push even more. The veil, it's kind of funny, like, Seema just keeps picking up these small items. Like, he got the Glimmer Cape first when it looked like they might be able to end the game, then he got the Veil. Now he's kind of at the point where I guess he'll build, like, a Force Staff or something next. He probably would have had an Magnum Scepter at this point, but of course then you wouldn't have been getting the value out of these smaller items along the way. And, another quick pause here. Looks like someone wasn't quite back from his little AFK session there. Oh, nice. Classic shop bug.
For a second, before I saw the second text, I thought, like, you just knew Russian suddenly. I was just like, holy cow, more facts I didn't know.
No, we don't actually learn that up here.
I don't know.
It's not required reading.
I hope you can see it from where you live.
Not on my coast.
Not on your coast? On your coast?
No.
I mean, just try. Try really hard.
I'll do my best.
Draw distances, man. Yeah, I have no idea what's being said. But I think that, obviously, when we take a look at the net worth, we are 15,000 net worth ahead for Vega. Only a little over 2.5k experience this happens, because obviously you're grouped up. I do think HR, as you mentioned, they just need one good team fight. They can get so much off the back of that, because if they can kill 3 or 4 members of Vega, the push is real from their side.
I think HR are just thinking, like, how do we fight Roche? Like, that's got to be the play, because these high ground sieges are just going way too well for Vega. It's clear that they're very comfortable. They have a set position that they're always using. You can kind of see Solo. It's interesting to me because he's not, like, at first I was a little bit, like, questioning the way he was positioning, because he was always off to the side. He wasn't sitting with the rest of his team when he went for the swap back, but it's actually obviously incredibly smart, because if you're sitting in the back with the rest of your team when you swap with the Drow Ranger, all that means is that you get blinked over,
yeah.
And then you get the Echo Slam, the Dream Claw, and everything like that. So although it's like an unfavorable position to shove the Drow into, you're just going to have to rely on the rest of your team engaging them as they go after the Drow. So,
and Drow is one of two heroes, I think, where, I'm trying to remember who's the other one, but one of two heroes where the more you die, like, you're, as your death amounts increase on the Drow, your hero win rate actually goes up.
On the Drow or the Venge?
No, sorry, Venge.
That's... Okay.
I'm chugging this tea, it's still not waking up the brain. But yeah, it's just a really interesting interaction, and even though Solo is sitting at 2 and 7, right, he's done a lot of work this game.
Oh yeah, like, Vengeance Aura's gotta be... The death aspect of it has gotta be the most underappreciated thing in the game, honestly. It is so ridiculous. Like, you're taking away 36% of damage. All damage.
Especially, like, with this Chaos Knight. Right?
It's crazy.
It's
yeah.
Hurt those illusions a lot, too.
And anyone who's obviously, like, nearby the person who killed you, it's something that I still don't see teams playing around. Like, I've harped on that a little bit, but you'll see, like, a push where one person has the debuff aura, and they don't move away from the team, and you end up reducing, like, the ridiculous amount of push damage that you end up having.
Puck has managed to buy up the Aghanim Scepter.
Yeah, they need that.
So we'll see if this can get anything happening here. I really like this pickup over maybe something smaller like the Yules, which would have arguably saved his life just for a later day. Nature's Prophet still hasn't quite committed to this push. Probably just, you know, press an R in the jungle. That's what you do. So he's waiting on- what is he waiting on? He's just standing there. Maybe he wants to bring the Purge creep with him. It's good creep, but either way, the high ground push should be coming shortly. They're just waiting on perfect positioning. Pasha actually being very cautious with this Aegis.
Yeah, I mean, now that you've got that, this is the battleground. Like, this is where our game either ends or keeps going. And they can keep the push up in the mid lane using the Treants, so Pasha, once again, we just see this kind of superior positioning.
Yeah, and they do have a ward here. Now, they've picked up a gem onto the Oracle. We've also Guardian Greaves on the Oracle. This is something that shouldn't be underestimated. In that False Promise, the double healing from Guardian Greaves, because they give you 15 armor and regen when you're below 20% health, actually can change the course of a game around, right? That can save someone's life who shouldn't have, or bring them back up to full health. But the tower push, it's coming in. The Nature's Prophet Treants just being a real pain, trying to actually kind of walking around, but it looks like now they're going to go on the rain tracks. The Phantasm has come out from Illidan. He needs to get something done in this window of having the illusions up, but it looks like it was just a zoning Phantasm. I have to imagine they're still trying to make something happen, but they're losing damage on their range tracks in mid. Illidan leading the charge forward, solo getting ready to just throw out a magic missile. There it is, though. The pull in with the Reality Rift, and they don't quite catch him in the Static Storm. The ult still hasn't come out. Finally, Dream Crow comes out. This ult from the Witch Doctor doing a lot of good work there. Brings down the Venge and Seam of the Slayer. Now no one in a lot of trouble has all those illusions pounding on him. BKB won't save him from that, and Pasha has to just run away, but Afa Ninja with the jump forwards, and it's looking like Pasha fissured up. That's going to be life, and they have the lockdown for the second. In the meantime, Nature's Prophet Mag just doing good work on the back lines. They're only going to send in three to try and kill off Pasha. It looks like they should have it. They still have Echo Slam, so I don't think they'll use it here, but they should have the lockdown. But Pasha just... What is this? I know it's nighttime, but this is just like the Wiggly Snake game. Pasha going to be just going to eventually fall. Will finally go down here, but... A really nice hold from HR. They did not expend Echo Slam for that one, although they did lose the ranged racks in mid.
Yeah, everything just set up by this ward. Really surprised they don't have like a gem or anything out here from the side of Vega or any sort of sentries, because you know that if you have this vision up on the high ground, either provided by there or over here, that's really the only way HR can actually engage into you outside of the base. So I was kind of surprised the way Afa Ninja was positioning himself, but Vega had the right idea. Like, again, they chose the right time to back away. They saw the Phantasm get popped, they weren't in range of initiation, and they started to back, but they got greedy. They saw Illidan come out, and they're like, oh, we can get him, we can get the pick, we can end the game. And instead of just leaving and running away, they end up paying, like, their entire team. Other than, of course, Mag here, so... Another slight misstep by them. They still have a massive lead in terms of the overall net worth. Like, that's gonna happen here when you've been dominating the map for so long, but...
Experience is back to zero, which small but important, because it does mean, obviously, that the team fight from HR, it gets stronger as those abilities scale. And I think Vega, understanding this, they went back for the Mjolnir on Nature's Prophet. So if they lose another team fight, he is going to hit the crap out of their buildings and creeps. So this mid-Rax may just end up falling in the next engagement, even if HR win it.
Yeah, and how about Ivan, the Yule Warrior in the last fight, too? Damn, that Death Ward. I did not see that coming. It's crazy how much more range you get out of the bounces when you're comboing that up, but what that comes down to, and we saw the Echo Slam, we saw the Dream Coil, and it's all flashy, it's all wombo combo, but you really need every single tool at your disposal. And they got it off this time, which is great. They're going to have to do it again, but the problem is when you're using this wombo combo, when you're going for that, then there's just going to be Mag in the mid lane. And he's going to get your other melee racks. And who can deal with that? Like, if you miss one element of this push, or rather this, like, defense of your high ground, like, can you stop the other four heroes on Vega then?
I mean, you can even defend perfectly, but unless you kill all five of them, you still have the mag factor.
Yeah.
Now, correct me on this if I'm wrong. I believe the initial Death Ward can miss on Butterfly, but then the bounces cannot. The bounces, yes. Okay, excellent, folks. So we're going to see some of that in action. And again, they are just posturing both sides. Very patient here, because Mag, of course, can pressure their other lanes. What do you think is perfect? I mean, for HR, how do you get Mag to actually come to the fight? Because I feel like they need Mag in there to win this one.
Oh, who just picked that? Oh, okay, never mind. That was Radiant. It's... Like, he'll show up, but honestly, he's just waiting for them to commit. Like, he sees the commit, he just TP's mid. And he just TP's right on top of the racks, and then you lose. That's like his whole play here. All he needs to do is just be sitting somewhere where he's not going to die. They have the double ultimate again available, and that's what they used as the timing last time, so that'll be it once more here. So this one will see them push in, and this is where Shasha needs to be. So this is where I thought Alpha Ninja would be last time, when they had the good vision, but Shasha with the Shadow Blade, adding another element to his initiation here with the Force Staff 2.
Yeah,
Now he's the initiator.
He is full surprisery mode. We'll see whether this one pays off. Shadowblade's still on cooldown. Their ranged racks will fall here. Goddamn, throws out the fortunes and Illidan pops the Manta.
They need sentries for Vega. Like, this is such a mistake.
I don't think they realize it. Yeah, there's gonna be the blink forwards. Dreamcoil manages to hit on three. Immediately the BKB out. These are just Manta illusions, but that's the Phantasm. Echo Slam manages to hit on three, but two of them BKB. They bring down the Oathshaker immediately. This Static Storm stopping any effectiveness coming out. Illidan will get one kill with the help of the Death Ward, but there are more mags. BKB has worn out. Illidan silenced out, but he should be able to Reality Rift. Goes in on Seema. They've seen it all. They've got a gem here in Mag while he is pounding away on them. False Promise on Illidan. They don't even care about it. Pasha caught up.
Yeah, there goes Mag.
Yeah, Mag is back in their base, and now suddenly they have to TP away, but this fight's still happening. No one goes down to the Maledict eventually, but Mag, he's already gotten one Rax in bottom. He's working on mid while his creeps are working on the bottom. This could just be Mega creeps. They're trying to hold it out. Can they kill them? They do save the bottom Rax. But just
Pasha's one there, though.
Never mind. Pasha just walks right up. He's gonna go down for this, but he's finished the objective. Mega creeps up for Vega now. And how on earth can HR find a way to stop them? There's gonna be the blink forward. Solo also looking to be in a lot of trouble. Goddamn, taking a lot of damage, though, from Mag. He's getting some good uphill misses. Has to pop that False Promise. He should be fine here. They managed to kill a Solo. Now Mag, the next one that they have to pick off. Their mid racks are going... Oh, the mid tower is going down. Mag taking a lot of damage here. He finally falls, but they've already lost one tower in mid.
Yeah, that was actually so well played by Meg. This guy, like, he continues to impress me every single game, because the creeps were just hitting the mid lane, and every single hero, and all other 9 heroes were down here in this engagement. And rather than TPing in onto this Rax here, Meg TPs into the fight, and I was questioning it. I'm like, wow, I'm really surprised. Like, I feel like you just end the game, but knowing that the glyph was up, he goes into the fight, uses his BKB, dukes it out a little bit, knows that the fight's gonna be lost, so he just refreshes, BKBs, ulties, and then he uses his TP once more to head into the base. So, glyph goes off at that point, but by then, there were enough heroes down, enough spells used, that it was just free. So, just well played, you know, just playing this game completely to a T. You know, bouncing HR around like they're the losing person in a tennis match here. Like, they just cannot cover enough ground all the time. And it seemed inevitable for Vega that they were going to win this one out. I'm impressed HR held out that long, honestly, because it is a drow lineup, but that's just Megas, you know.
I mean, there's just not much you can do against it. Dota is a game where all you have to do is destroy your enemy's ancient, and there's not... You don't have to do it by having the kill advantage, right? You can do it at a deficit, and even now, of course, Vega way ahead because they just took a bunch of racks. They're actually super far behind when it comes to experience, but it doesn't matter. They would have to make so many mistakes here for HR to get back into this one, and it's at least two sets of big mistakes because, of course, we've got buybacks, and then we've got two tier 2s in mid, which is, like, their best option because it's the shortest lane and me drawing weird shit on the map. I just don't know how you get back in.
No, it's I think this, it's like 26 or somewhere between 26 to 28 teams have ever come back from Megas, and I think only 5 of them were anywhere other than like two or three minutes after the last Rax fell. Like, it's only ever that massive pushback that actually gets the win where you commit everything for that last Rax. It's so extremely rare that you end up holding this out and winning the game.
I think, as you said, it's like, I don't know how you get back against this now. Something, obviously, I think the team the most famous for doing well against Mega Creeps is Alliance. The other problem with coming back against Mega Creeps is so few teams have experience. If you're in this position in a scrim, you GG. You don't normally hold out in a scrim. You just say, hey, we messed up the laning phase, let's try to work on that. So I can't imagine that HR is saying, oh yeah, we've practiced against Megas a bunch, guys. We know exactly how to handle this.
I mean, plus, like, we see this all the time, too. You end up with a Mjolnir puck, right?
Yeah.
Like, this is your life now. You have, like, 3 supports on your team, in between an Oracle and a Witch Doctor and an Earthshaker, so...
I don't know if you saw, but Oracle actually picked up a Mask of Madness before selling it for the Glads and the Maelstrom. That's where we are in this game. Everybody needs D push. We do have a Heart coming out onto Illidan. I mean, we see good item progression on HR, but of course, as you mentioned, they have to expend so much of it on dealing with Megas, and they have no chance of contesting Roche.
Mjolnir Oracle.
Yeah, it's good. You don't like that? I like
it. Man, it's that base attack time though. Everyone was always hyping this guy up, you know? They're like, oh, he's gonna be the best mid ever. Just you guys wait. Well, here you go, guys. You got
they
it now.
They just need Necro books, and then they're golden. What is Oracle's faster than Jug's base attack time?
I think it's actually the same, I believe. The only one, I think Oracle and Jug are tied, I want to say, and then it's like Alchemist with ulti is the fastest.
And then Necro Book, right? The melee Necro Book.
Oh yeah, that thing just like beats away at you, man.
I love the melee Necro Book, but either way, Vega, they're getting the Roshan. There is nothing HR can do here to contest, and oh, I don't want to call it, because I would love to see a huge big comeback from HR, but I just don't know how, I don't even know what that would look like, because we go to buybacks, if I can find the right menu. There we go. Actually, only two buybacks up on Vega, but one of them is the Nature's Prophet, who can instantly get back into the fight.
The hard life.
What? Oh, I'm sorry. I thought I said something wrong again. This is just, I'm chugging tea. Chugging tea.
You're fine. You're good.
Yeah, I like to believe so. Anyway, we have sentries everywhere. I'm really liking this action up from HR. They're trying to make sure their base is well protected. And albeit, you know, all the Mjolnirs being out on people, it's gonna be good damage in the team fight. I'm trying to look at the upside here, Matt.
Well, you get one Echo Slam out of five people and suddenly it's like a thunderstorm in there, man. Everyone's gonna be right-clicking away in Mjolnirs.
There's like no cooldown or something on that, right? There's just like, you can be hit by five lightnings, right? If every person on the team, there's no cooldowns, there's no weird interactions there. So there could be a lightning storm, you know?
Like mad RNG.
Yeah.
Oh, here comes the smoked in play though.
They are standing right up there. There's gonna be a swap onto Goddamn. He does sick. Use that Ghost Scepter. He's still alive. He pops that Pulse Promise on himself. And now Solo taking a lot of damage here from Illidan. He's gonna bring one down. There's a Static Storm off to the side, not doing nearly enough. No one taking that full ult from the Witch Doctor, and it's bouncing all over the place. The Echo Slam underwhelming though onto BKB targets. And now Illidan, he's in a lot of trouble. He is able to buy back. They're gonna see him come right on out of that base. They still have not pushed in Pasha. BKB getting low. Going to be taking a bit of damage here. Seema, though, going to stand there and take a lot of damage. Pasha uses the silence, but they should have the disruptor at the very least. And they do have this oracle. Oh, they're going to get themselves a gem. That's nice. Shockle going forwards more. Neither of these drows are real, so they're not going to get that. And this courier just sitting there with the drums. So, but yeah, oracle with the Mjolnir able to help save the base.
Yeah, I was like all hyped up, so I was like, alright, game's over, because they had the nice little kinetic field into the swap, but they didn't throw down the Static Storm for the Oracle, and I was just thinking, that's the play, like, get rid of the Oracle, and then no one gets saved, that's the game, but I can understand they didn't want to commit it, but he has way too many saving tools, like, he has a Ghost Scepter, he has his ultimate, he has the Greaves, like, you need to just blow him up.
Now, it was technically an almost even fight, because Vega did pick off the Chaos Knight and
the Shaker.
Shaker. So their buybacks are on cooldown for another 6 minutes or so, but they did lose a gem. And Aegis timing, only 2.5 minutes left on it. So Vega, they got a win. I mean, they got a really big window, but it got a slightly smaller. It's like someone closed it a little. I'm trying to say that HR maybe can pull a rabbit out of this hat.
It's so hard when you only have one tower, though. Like, you need to wipe them twice, and then take a tier 1 and maybe a tier 2. I highly doubt you'd get to tier 3 before they were back up. Then you have to win that engagement again against the Nature's Prophet that's going to be ratting the other lanes and casting ultimate with Mega Creeps.
There are very few buybacks at the ready for Vega, so let's see if they can make this happen. If they do make another mistake here and the Aegis gets reclaimed or is just killed off twice by Illidan with amazing phantasms, they will be in a bit of a pickle. But neither team really wanting to blink too much. Chuckle just chilling, invisible. It's really hard here for him. I don't see where he can get a huge big Echo Slam. Okay, the creeps are coming in. There's going to be the kinetic field. They do manage to pop the Phantasm. They're going in on the sidelines. Pasha has been caught up. And at the same time, they picked off Magno. They don't quite hit him. They need some more attacks. And the Death Ward not hitting onto anyone. Alpha Ninja taking a lot of damage, but a huge Echo Slam from Choclo. And Pasha, this will be life number one. Can they bring down Solo? Alpha Ninja does end up blowing up. Does have buyback. Solo should go down. Pasha now going to go on to Yolo Warrior, but isn't able to seal the deal. Monta comes out. Pasha still running away. play, Illidan has Reality Rift up in 2 seconds when the silence comes off of cooldown, and Pasha in a lot of trouble. They have the damage here. They should be able to bring down this Drow Ranger. They are still chasing. She is bringing them on some Benny Hill Mary chase, but they finally bring her down, but they lost their one tower left. An HR hold again, but a costly one.
Oh, jeez. We could be here a while. Like, it's so hard to make it that far into the base up against the puck. You've got the Death Ward. They've been doing some pretty cheeky little plays using smoke so that you're getting these kind of positionings out from Ivan and as well from Sasha that they're not really expecting. So you're getting off some really good ultimates that you're kind of surprised at. Mega Creep's always coming in. Means Echo Slam is always going to be unbelievably dangerous.
Yeah. I was, like, really worried.
Distance
for
you
him.
Have to cover.
Did you see, like, that Echo Slam? I was, like, legit worried because nobody was grouping up on Vega, but he only managed to hit 2, but then about 10 Mega Creeps. So it turned out to be a pretty good Echo.
Yeah. It's... At the same time, though, like, even after that, how far do they get? Anywhere?
No, about here. About here. We're having a bit of giggles, but it is a really hard game for HR, and they've already done a really impressive job here at all. When we take a look at the net worth, it is holding steady, which is ridiculous when your side is Megan.
It's insane.
It should be going straight down, because Vega should be farming up the entire map, but they are getting...
I don't know if they, like, just have gripes with Vega, and they're just like, no, we're not giving you this free win, you know? We're gonna wait. We're gonna make you finish it out here.
Okay, they do catch out YOLO Warrior a little bit, but unwilling to commit despite having Megas. About to pound in onto him, and we're back to stalemate territory. Now the buybacks, Pucks, I know, is still on cooldown. 2.5 minutes on the Earthshaker and the Chaos Knight.
Oh my god. I was about to say, but the real question is, where is your...
Okay, there's gonna be a swap. They finally decide to use the Static Storm. Illidan, he does not have buyback for this. The False Promise does come out, but he is in a lot of trouble, taking mass amounts of damage. Finally, the ult coming out. Death Ward bouncing around. Illidan has to get some work done. He manages to get the Phantasms out, and now Pasha taking lots of damage in the back lanes. Can the illusions kill him off? Yes, they bring down Pasha, but this base is taking so much damage.
Woo!
Echo Slams to clear off the creeps. Mag taking damage here. YOLO Warrior goes down, but he's already used his Death Ward. Goddamn, using that Ghost Scepter, keeping him alive, but where is the damage coming out, and it's looking like this may be it. The base taking damage. Pasha buys back and glyph down. GG, well played. And double.
Ooh, the aggressive GG. No one, please.
Yeah.
Okay.
A good game all around. A really nice hold from HR showing us what they can do. Vega secure their first place in the WePlay League. Nobody else can surpass them, so they're in, going to the LAN, is my understanding.
No, they looked really good this game. Like, it was a solid strat came out. Maybe it took longer to execute than you might hope, but most teams just would have tapped out earlier and made it look more impressive, you know what I mean? Like, it's still your very typical Drow lineup. It's harder to close it out at the end, but with only a single tower down, very difficult for Illidan and the boys to come back, but very impressive. I'm, you know, how often do you get to see, what, 5 Maelstrom? Oh, no, Illidan didn't join the club. So we got 4 Maelstroms, 2 of those turning into Mjolnirs, so... It was a fun little game. HR, they are looking good considering they just picked up Illidan. You know, they're still figuring a few things out here, but I have hopes for them. Make a comeback with the team.
I'm pretty excited. This was just a strat that I think they got a little outdrafted with the Drow pick, right? It was a more difficult lineup to play into, and Vega executed really well. So, well played to them. Either way, folks, that's going to be it for CIS games, but we do have a European game coming up in only 45 minutes, thanks to this game taking about 50. We will be back for that. I believe you're still with me, Mott Pax, right?
Yeah,
so we've got, it's, let me just actually pull it up because I'm going to say the wrong names. It is Adfinem versus...
Prius,
yes. Which is kind of, I guess Prius is no longer CIS, so never mind. Either way, folks, that'll be up here in about 45 minutes from now, starting at 11 a.m. PST or 20 CET. We'll see you all then. I'm Llama Down Under, joined by Mott Pax. We're by those names on Twitter. Feel free to check us out, and I will take all feedback on improving the casting. Mott Pax, as you saw in this cast, perfect, flawless.
What can I say? I mean, I do what I can, so.
So
hit me up on Twitter, guys. Come say hi. It'll be great.
We'll
make friends for life.
Friends for life. That's a good offer.
Yeah, I make good promises.
We'll be back in about 45 minutes, guys. Please have some fun while you're waiting, and we'll see you soon.